In my big dream imagining, we get to distill the deepest stories and the truths that come out of community and out of history. When we have our voices heard and have our messages heard, we become leaders.
Yitzup Uweliel Siaya CM Sialakwa Ich Imchna Eten Antha Jada Gabrielle Pape. This is the Drawing Wisdom Video Podcast. I think we're in season 3 and this is episode 1. What fun, we get to be here again. And today we're in conversation with Michelle Good, who is a Cree writer and advocate and all-round fantastic person. So let's dive into that conversation and see where it brings us. Michelle, it's really, really nice to see you.
It's always nice to see you, Jada, and to have a time where we can dedicate to conversation is pretty good.
One of the things that you said right before we started recording is, I've got a thing for trees. And I can totally relate to that. That resonates with me. But I want to hear more about that. Will you tell me something about that?
Well, you know, maybe it's because I was born in a place that was all about trees. And my memories of Saskatchewan when I was a very little child is all about poplars and birch and tarragona bushes. And then, of course, there's the medicine. You know, all of the trees, virtually all of the Indigenous trees in Canada bear medicine, you know, so they're so special in that regard. And they've been represented in my writing in that way, in that they're not only a place of solace, but a place of healing as well. And, you know, there's what could be more special than a tree in terms of the work their roots do, their leaves, everything. Their medicine, they hold the earth together, they provide shade, they provide oxygen, they're magnificent.
Yeah, I agree with all of that. I also feel like they're really good teachers for us, that if we pay attention to what they're telling us in the different seasons, then there's really good information for how we can live in relationship to the lands and the seasons as well.
Well, you know, and I mean, unfortunately, yeah. With the rise of, you know, raw capitalism and the rise of Christian domination, we forget that we are no more than a tree. as humans on the earth, we are no more than a tree. And by assuming a certain dominance over other life forms on earth, we get completely out of rhythm, out of the necessary rhythm that we're supposed to be in order for the earth and the world to keep turning as it should. And we become a destructive influence rather than an inherent part of that whole system.
Yeah, we dominant culture tells us to be very human-centric, and we lose the relational aspect for sure.
Genesis, the first book of the Bible, and man shall have dominion over the earth. Right there is when it all changed. Yes, right in the first book.
That's so toxic.
Isn't it just? Right? It's, you know, but that's what put us, and, you know, if you look at the dominating influence of the church throughout the world, regardless of Catholic or whatever, and then you think of that in terms of the relationship to the earth, there's this overwhelming influence that we are above the earth, that we are superior to the earth and all other life forms, which is, of course, absurd, right? As well as factually incorrect. But when you think about, you know, such a powerful ideology, a powerful dogma, that in its very fundamental principles thinks of the earth in that way, thinks of the earth as something that's just for our use, as opposed to the thing that nurtures us, that supports us, that saves us, right? I remember saying in an interview once, We humans are the only thing that the earth does not need. And it's true. The earth needs everything. Everything that is natural, the earth needs. It doesn't need us. We need the earth. And that relation is completely flipped on its head in contemporary society, in sort of modern capitalist resource extraction focused society. We think of ourselves as, you know, yeah, we don't think of ourselves as being as puny and weak and dispensable as we are. And we are, you know, and it was so interesting, you know, when COVID first hit in 2020, when we had the major lockdowns with COVID and everybody was staying home all the way around the world. And what was happening was that the animals were taking over, right? The animals were walking down, you know, Rodeo Drive in Los Angeles, right? And, it, you know, and that's what would happen if humanity just disappeared tomorrow. Everything would be just fine, right? The creatures would come back, the plants would come back. You know, it's like when you see plants growing between the cracks of cement, right? It would all set itself right. And if we could only think of ourselves in that very humble way, I think the way that we treated the earth would be fundamentally different, totally different.
Mm-hmm. And it didn't, you know, that initial return for birds and coyotes and all the different animals, it didn't take long. Like they're not like species is that give up hope and just kind of go like, well, I guess this is how it is. But humans are kind of like, well, I don't know what to do. And they give up hope, right? We just sort of go like, I'm totally despondent and I don't know what to do about this. So I guess I'll just buy into it. But the animals were like, oh, check it out.
Yeah, because it's in their DNA, right? And it's in our DNA, but we've civilized it out of ourselves. And, you know, and that's the thing, is that we just surrender. And you're absolutely right. We just surrender and say, well, you know, what difference is it if I, you know, use plastic bags? What difference if I throw my pop can in the ocean? You know, it's all so screwed up now anyway, right? And that's what we see with all these ridiculous billionaires, you know, spending amounts of money that would entirely ameliorate poverty globally, so they can go to space, so that they can be the first folks up there, so they can colonize space, and then, you know, when everything falls apart, which they are committed to, the systems that will make it fall apart, that they'll be the first in space because they can afford it, right? And it's so bizarre that they would think of that as being the best possible use of their wealth, right? It's crazy.
Yeah, I wonder, like, there's, for me, I don't hear that they're even thinking about this is the best possible use. They're just thinking about, like, you know, what my late dad used to call the buy me's. Like, you know, you'd get the buy me's, like, buy me this, buy me that, I want this, I want that. And it's like, just for, like, get out of yourself for a second, and there's so much more.
Well, and that's, you see, that's the thing. And I mean, I'm getting old, right? I'm 66 this year. I mean, oh no, I am 66. I'll be 67 this year. And I'm old enough to remember life being very different. And you know, how we weren't entirely absorbed with the buy-me's and with the individualism, you know, that there still was some notion, even in non-Indigenous communities, of a sense of community, of a sense of the greater good, of a sense of, you know, I mean, no matter what you may think about it, the example I like to use is during World War II, when everybody, basically everybody grew a victory garden, right? Everybody grew a garden, everybody chipped in together as community to, you know, be able to provide for things that were, you know, that were scarce because of the war effort. And I mean, it's, you know, I'm not saying yay war, but I'm just saying that notion of, you know, coming together at a time of calamity. And then you compare that to, you know, social response to COVID. And did we get that? No, we got the freedom convoy, right? It's like we got people saying, my rights. And it's about, you know, individualism versus we need to pull together to, you know, as a species, as societies, we need to pull together to survive this crazy event that's, you know, this virus that's trying to cleanse the earth. And, you know, but that to me is just such a phenomenally excellent measure of, you know, how far down the garden path of individualism, which is an inherent part of capitalism, which is, you know, the fundamental, you know, global buy me, that's where we're at. And that's not good news.
No. And, no. You know, it's actually that same period of time when people were growing victory gardens and finding ways to rally in community, right? They weren't like, I'm going to think about a community, but the idea of community was still current enough that people could tap into it. And
they
that's actually the same time. Yes. Yes. So they didn't have to create it. Like now we have to go around and like think about it and create community. They don't just exist anymore. It's not the way of being and knowing, right?
Yeah. Yeah.
And that's the same time we were sort of deprioritizing and being taught don't trust intuition, like around birth and death, and we were medicalizing all sorts of aspects of day-to-day humanity and life. And so like a huge time of change came right after the Second World War. I mean, for the last 200 years, but... Yeah.
Well, and incrementally since the Industrial Revolution, right? I mean, you go from feudalism to the Industrial Revolution and to now. And if you just sat down, if you had time, I'm busy, sorry. And if you had time to sort of, you know, take a look at the correlation between the destruction of community fabric, okay, and the industrialization and then globalization of economy of the world, I think you would see correlations all the way down that path. And, you know, it's, And now what I find really interesting right now, though, after COVID, is all of the people in the world that had all that time where they had to stay at home and they had lots of time to think about things. And the number of people that are saying, no, I'm not going back to work. You know, I'm not going to work in the way that we used to work because that's convenient to your profit motive. I need to have a life. And, you know, the situation, I mean, the world is totally geared, whether we believe it, know it, or whatever, it's totally geared to, you know, basically wage enslavement, right? Where the vast majority of people in the world must work at least 9 to 5 or, you know, 12 to 4 or whatever it is that they work in order to just have enough so that they're not starving, so that they're not, you know, on the street. And as we see, that's not the case for the vast majority anymore. It takes just a minute right now for people to lose the illusion of, you know, material security. And all of this is in the name of the greed of that 0.1%. The 0.1%, not even the 1%, the 0.1%, the billionaires, right? Who, for some reason, you know, being a billionaire isn't enough, that they still have to sap the human resources of the earth, of the people, you know, to maintain absolutely unnecessary, you know, ridiculous wealth that they couldn't spend in their lifetime if they tried, right? Because they're just addicted to buy me, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, it's a scary time.
Yeah, it's really easy to feel very defeated very quickly. And like I think a lot about where do we find our inner resources to keep doing, you know, to get into good trouble and to remain here, right?
Yeah.
What do you do to stay well, restored and well?
Well, it's kind of ridiculous, but it's true, is that I comfort myself knowing that I'm not going to be alive for long. And you know, and when I say long, I mean, I expect, well, maybe I'll live till the average, right? But that's only 14 years, right? 80.7 months is the, 80 years and 7 months is the average for a woman in Canada to live. And so I comfort myself that I will not be the one that sees the destruction that's on the horizon. And that's, you know, that's kind of selfish, but it's what, if I focused on what I see coming all the time, I would be paralyzed. And so I comfort myself and say, yeah, it's okay, you'll be off with Jay pretty soon anyway. So just, you know, keep going, right? You know, keep doing the best that you can. And, you know, and the other thing is, you know, I ask myself, am I encouraging people to do their best? You know, with what I do, with my little world, with my little sphere of influence, am I doing my best to encourage others to do their best? And that's a standard that I hold for myself, and try to do to the best of my ability, and that's all I can do.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that piece about we'll all be with Jay, and you know, and all will be good. I think I spend a lot of my living life in conversation with my head, and a lot of my conversation is with people who I have known and who I have loved and who are no longer alive. And I remember my mom said to me at the 4-year anniversary after my dad died that I said, I can feel him. I haven't felt him, but I could feel him, and I didn't know why. And she said, he's always been there. He's always having the other side of the conversation. He's with you. And that you can feel him means that he's closer, like that. And I've never, like, I don't think I have any answers or any deep understanding, but I also have the humility to go with that. And I find it really hopeful, actually, to live on, you know, to have this earth walk, knowing that someday I'll get to sit in a different kind of conversation with my ancestors, with our ancestors.
You know, and since my boy died, it was a way that I was leaning towards believing anyway in my intuitive place, right? But they're right there. They're like right there. They're the only thing that stops us from being able to communicate the way you and I are communicating right now is our limited ability to perceive, right? But there are so many indigenous cultures and other cultures that think of time as happening all at once, right? That time is not on a continuum, that it's all at once, and that our ability to participate in a particular concept of time is all up here. And I've had like moments since Jay died that I'm just like, yep. And you know, and they are, and they, you know, and that's the other thing that when we think about spirit and we think about love, those are the tangible intangibles. Those are the things that are, you know, what life is all about. And those things don't die, you know, spirit doesn't die. You know, you could think of yourself as a, you know, as a peanut, right? And we die, the shell, it's just the shell, right? And, you know, the heart, the soul, the spirit of us, it just, you know, we become pure spirit at that point, and far more powerful in our ability to communicate, to, you know, to be, I guess, a certain kind of spiritual purity, I guess, not hindered by, not hindered by physicality, or not hindered by the limitations of things like gravity, right? Like the temporal world, right? We're not limited by that at that moment. Or when we move into pure spirit. And so, you know, I kind of freak people out sometimes because, you know, I tell them I'm okay to die. It's like, that doesn't mean I want to or I'm ready to, but we don't get to choose that. If that's one lesson I learned from Jay's sudden death, his sudden unexplained death, is that we don't get to choose that. That moment is chosen for us. And so our job is to just be ready in our life. And I am. I'm totally good with it. And in fact, looking forward to it in some ways as, the next adventure. But yeah. Yeah. I'm keeping a list of those who I will haunt.
Well, it's almost like there'll be all kinds of answers or all kinds of validation when we move into pure spirit. All these things, I'm like, see, it is real. It'll be the best I told you so ever.
Right. I know. And, you know, it's really interesting because in the last, the last 15 or so years of her life, I became very close to my mother's sister. And she died in September 2021, and she was 98 years old, and her and I became very, very close. And that's what she used to say all the time: there's some things we just cannot know until we die, right? But when we do die, we do know. And I totally believe that. And sort of thinking in that way too is very comforting too, because you can just stop vexing over things, right? You can, you know, something happens, you're going, why is that? Well, you know, it'll come to me, right? Or it won't. It'll come to me now or it won't. It'll come to me later if it doesn't come to me now. And what I am meant to know and understand in this lifetime, I will. And, you know, and I put my, that's what I put my life into. My life's energy has always been about, you know, learning the most that I can learn, understanding the most that I can understand, and you know, just doing the best with what I've got.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and also that we don't actually need very much, that we've got a lot.
Yeah. You know, my great-grandmother was an amazing human being. She was born in, I love this, she was born in 1856. I was born in 1956. I love that little symmetry that we have. And she lived in a tent in Saskatchewan year round until she was 80 years old. And, you know, my grandfather built her a cabin and she said, no, it's not healthy to live inside, right? But just in that period of time, okay, so, you know, I think it was, add 50 to 1856 and you get 1906. Okay. 1906 is more in the realm of people's conception. They don't think of it as a long, 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 long time ago. And here is this woman that all she needs is her tent, her medicines, right? She was an herbalist type medicine person. And, you know, her tools, things that she needed to, you know, to provide for herself. That's all she needed. And when we think about, again, going back to this notion of pre-industrial humans, we all lived that way, regardless of whether we were, well, we were all indigenous to somewhere. And we all lived that way in a very simple way based on what we actually need. And, you know, that didn't, and who was it, that terrible person, that terrible, terrible philosopher, what was his name, that life is nasty, brutish, and short, what was his name? It's such a long time ago I studied that.
Alan McEachern.
No. He was a philosopher around the time of John Locke and all of those sort of philosophers. Hobbes, that's what his name was. And that was his perception of humanity, is that life was nasty, brutish, and short. That was, I think, at a moment in time when people were, where you had the terrible class differences of the phenomenally rich and the dirt poor. And, you know, the dirt poor in, you know, say maybe that would have been the 18th century, right? Living in horrific conditions, their life was nasty, brutish, and short. But that was because we had stepped away from a natural way of being in the world. And we've lost, I fear, you know, I couldn't live out there in my tent. I'm sorry, I couldn't. I would die, right? But that's because we've become so weak. We've become so so beyond, so separate from the earth and the necessities the necessary ways of being that the earth requires. We're so far away from that that we cannot survive, you know, if the power goes out or the water gets turned off or, you know, whatever, we just have no clue anymore. And I think I have a little slightly more clue, but not really, right? And, you know, and that's, that will be the end of us, really. It will be the end of us. Because all of the infrastructure will ultimately fail. And we're starting to see that now, I think. You know, people talk about the failure of the supply chain, and I don't think it's the failure of the supply chain. I think it's the failure. It's the ultimate overload of a system that can't function like that anymore, right? But we'll see. I try not to be too gloomy.
Well, it's the colonial project and its reveal, like its shortcomings. Like it's a failed project, and now we're seeing it. Some of us have always known it, but I think en masse, that's what this supply chain issue is a failing system. You said something about the animals, and it's in their DNA, you know, the animals coming back or never having left, but just using the roadways. And when you said it's in their DNA, it really got me thinking about how we think about science in like dominant culture says, you know, we use terms like DNA and scientific terminology for things that actually for our people, we've always known and we've had very clear explanations for. And, you know, so my background's in the world of counseling psychology. And so lots of my thoughts are around that. And like one of the examples of, you know, we use science or mainstream languages, we call it disassociation or dissociation when people have a traumatic experience. But our people have always talked about that as, you know, your spirit jumps out of you. And the idea of DNA, our people have always had a very deep understanding of DNA. You know, it's why we braid our hair and why we don't leave residue of ourselves around, because people can take it and do things with it. And yeah, the language that we use.
Well, and I think about John.
Something.
Yeah, I think about John Trudell, and he says it's in our DNA, as opposed to our DNA. He says our DNA, our descendants and ancestors, right? And that's how he explains that, and that's what it is. But when you conflate DNA with DNA, it gives that explanation that you're talking about right now, is that it's always been, even if we didn't have, you know, ribonucleic or blah kind of words to attach to it, right? We had the understanding that, you know, the totality of creation is in our hair, is in our skin, is in our fingernails, is because we are creation, right? We are the object of creation, and or not the object, the outcome of creation, right? So, mm-hmm. Yeah, it's going to be interesting. I'll come visit you after I die.
Ancestors. Okay. And it's a funny thing. I think the friends and the family who have visited me.
Yeah.
I think it's like the most tangible thing, but completely intangible at the same mm-hmm. time. And mm-hmm. It's often for me, it's just like a rushing feeling that mm-hmm. moves through me, or it's a dream. And right. I wake up from my dream and feel like I just had the best visit with this person. Mm-hmm. And that's how I know it wasn't just a dream. It was a visitation.
Yeah. You know how it is.
And I think we're trained to
ignore those things mm-hmm. or explain them away. And one of the ways, like, I mean, some of them are really overt, like so overt that it's like, you know, in my waking times where things will happen, right? But another thing that happens that I just love, and sometimes I go to bed and say, let's have that, right? Is I get a certain warmth that is more than the warmth it's like an all-encompassing warmth in every cell of my being. And it's a glorious warmth. It's like, right? I'm in heaven, right? It's just like this incredible thing. It's like the sensation of white light, but not the visual, the physical sensation of white light, that depth of warmth, right? And it's just, I always wake up when I have one of those and I go, oh, thanks, Jay. It's just, you know, because it's always a gift. It's always a gift. I wake up more restored than ever and more, you know, able to deal with, you know, the stupidity of things, right? But,
It's like it refocuses our attention.
Mm-hmm. Well, it centers our attention, right? Yeah, well, which is the same thing. That's what you do when you focus, is you center, right? And, and just sort of brings you back to the understanding, whether it's a cognitive understanding or just a intuitive understanding, that everything's perfect, right? Everything is as it should be, and you just carry on. Because you know, if you believe in Creator, then how could he get it wrong? How could Creator get it wrong? And so there's reasons for everything that's happening. We may not know them. You know, I'll try and give you a clue after I go. But it's only when it's mostly when we have those moments when we can center in spirit that life becomes more peaceful.
Thanks for visiting the trees and the ancestors with me. That's fun.
Absolutely. Well, we went a long way.
Yeah. Thanks, Michelle. Take really good, gentle care.
Thank you, my dears.